Good evening and welcome to the WDSU Hot Seat. I'm Norman Robinson. New Orleans is known the world over as a cultural melting pot, kind of like a gumbo. But what if gumbo isn't any good? A skilled chef would fix it, right? And that's exactly what we hope to accomplish tonight when it comes to the ubiquitous race issue in the Crescent City. I'm joined now by Loyola University's Dr. Michael Cowan, who also serves on the New Orleans Crime Coalition, and former city councilman Oliver Thomas, who's also marketing director for Abide Home Health, actor and writer.
Yes. In
addition to all of his other many hats that he wears from time to time. Gentlemen, thank you for joining me for this important discussion. I say important, but first things first, Dr. Cowan, why is this magnificent gumbo that we call the city of New Orleans, in your opinion, threatened by racism, or is it?
Norman, I wouldn't say myself that it's threatened by racism. I would say that it's threatened by the inability of people to come together across racial lines and act for the benefit of the whole city.
Yeah, and I think Dr. Cobb, he's probably one of the few people I would have entered into the discussion, because he's one of the few people you can disagree with and find solutions around your disagreement. But the gumbo is actually threatened, because if you look at what's happening in New Orleans, there are too many people being left behind. Some people have a view, we're moving forward, one radio station sees it this way, another radio station sees it that way. And I think the tension politically and socially and economically is such now that it's brewing, it's really threatening the gumbo. And we have too much in common. Like, we're dressed, we both have on black suits with red ties and white shirts. You know, most people want the same things. But I think this underlying notion about race and somebody holding me back versus somebody having an advantage, versus somebody not trying as hard. You know, I think it's about time, if New Orleans really wants to be great, aren't we tired of being the murder capital in three or four different eras? Aren't we tired of being the city where we have more money per capita that passes through the city, but the poverty statistics for African-American men and African families are actually worse now? Aren't we tired of almost being good?
Well, that was going to be my next question. How does this issue of crime and race and economics factor into what we're discussing here tonight, Dr. Cowan?
Well, crime and race and economics. Why don't you ask a hard question next time, Norman? This is, again, let me go back really to my initial position. And I don't disagree with what Mr. Thomas just said. The city is threatened. I think what we're trying to grasp here is, what is it threatened by?
Mm-hmm.
And I think with respect to crime and with respect to economics, the only thing that is standing between us and a great future is serious multiracial agreement about the future of our city. And that's something that we can accomplish, I believe.
He's absolutely correct, a multiracial agreement. You know, we all have a stake in this city. If you think the sky is blue or aqua, you know, we all live here. Violence. Dr. Cowan and I are someone who understands public trust and public corruption in institutions. You know, we talk about the institution has to be so sacred that people's tax dollars are sacred, that the people who are minding the school, who are leaders, understand that it's not theirs. It's actually for the people that they represent. But we also have to begin to understand that if we're going to create a working class, we have to know that the money that comes to this town is also so sacred that we can build sustainable communities that can take care of themselves, that can help rid crime from their communities, not just with the police, but with the type of economic development and opportunity that creates strong middle class and strong working class. But that conversation has to happen, and we have to sign off at some point on an agreement that says economically, socially, spiritually, and culturally, we agree on these things and we pledge to move forward. That has never happened in New Orleans.
I know, it's never happened. How do we get to that point, Dr. Cowan?
Well, let me go back to murder, Norman.
Okay.
You know, as a person of faith, I read in the Bible, thou shalt not kill, as maybe the most fundamental moral imperative in all of Western culture and history. And here we sit in the city with 10 times a higher murder rate than the national average, and we know that this is one of the more violent nations in the world. So to me, that's a crime and it's a disgrace. The silver lining in that cloud to me is that it's a compelling issue that taps into the interests of every single group, although not to the same extent or in the same ways. And I believe that we're in the process of doing the things that we have to do to get our arms around that problem, not just to drop those numbers for a while, because we've done that before, but to drop them and, mm-hmm. and keep them down.
That's the thing that we definitely agree upon.
You think we're...
We can't keep practicing insanity.
But are we in a position now where we are about to get our arms around
Let me
problem?
Say this. It's so bad. It can only get better. And I think we have the type of people who are working actually to make it better. I actually think the disagreement and the public discourse gives us a chance for some solution. I'm also as a person of faith, in the book of Isaiah 43:19, God says, I will do a new thing in you. Well, New Orleans has tried just the police thing, and that hasn't worked. So maybe the new thing ought to be like Dr. Peter Dangerfield's report on poverty, some of the work the Human Relations has done, and say, let's start to strategically target people. If people are not taking advantage or participating in this economic opportunity right now, let's strategically invest in them. Let's start training, developing, and building a type of working class and middle class here. We will never be a sustainable and wholesome community if the majority of the population, which is about 65% African American, has some of the highest poverty statistics in the nation. You can't be successful like that. It's very difficult.
So how do you sell that, Dr. Cowan?
Well, the in terms of the getting our arms around the murder piece, Norman?
In terms of getting around, not only your arms around the murder, but around what he just talked about, those statistics, 65% of the population has the highest rate of poverty. And
well, it's obviously a complicated question, so let me just speak about one part mm-hmm. of it that I'm very familiar with, and that is that there are employers in this, not just in this city, but in this region, who need workers who will show up, learn what they have to learn, have some not even advanced educational background, but just decent literacy and math skills, who will take supervision, who will do the things that you have to do to hold down a decently paying job. Those jobs are going begging right now mm-hmm. because we have so many people who need work, but, for example, whose educational background disqualifies them, or whose attitude disqualifies them, or drugs, or a criminal background. That's going to take a serious, concerted mm-hmm. effort to give those people an opportunity to step out of the position that they're in right now and work their way into, you know, the American dream, which requires a job.
I want to explore this issue,
yes.
But I got to take a break.
Yes.
But I do want to, and don't let me forget, because I'm older than I normally do. So. I want to explore that when we come back.
Yes.
In addition to a bunch of other things. We're going to take a quick break now, but when we come back, who is best equipped to lead the effort to solve the race problem in New Orleans? Politicians or the clergy? Don't go far.